Greetings, our Hebrew Israelite sisters and brothers. This is L.D. Smith, the watchman on the wall. Israel, it is our Sabbath. Grab that King James. First and foremost, we want to wish all of our sisters and brothers all over a happy Sabbath. Now, going forward, we do want to apologize for last week's tardiness on our posting. We had technical difficulties. And it took us about 12 hours in order to try to correct it. You know, we had problems with the camera, also the audio, and different things that was beyond us getting it out there on time. But we do apologize here at LightOfMeNoMore.org, and I apologize, okay? Now, going into our teaching tonight, one of our brothers, he asked us to do this teaching about the Hebrew Israelites exiting this Egypt over here and other places and going back to Israel. And my sisters and brothers, I know that there's a lot of stuff, a lot of chatter that's out there that's going on about this exodus that we're supposed to take. But my brothers and sisters, that can be further from the truth. And I'm not saying it in a bad way to make anyone feel uncomfortable at all. It's just that it is the truth, and like I say, I'm going to prove it to you. And as I always say, think about what we're reading, and think about what you're hearing, okay? And then I'm quite sure that you will get a good understanding about this, because see, many of our people, they want to be led by another man, and see, that's what gets us in trouble. Because we want a leader, and if you read our history of our ancestors, they were the same way. We want us a king. We want a king. God saying, "Well, hey, look, I'm your king. No, we want a king down here. You know, okay, well, that what you want? Then I'll give you one." And if you guys know the story, and you guys know what happened, you know about that. See, so we have to be very, very careful about following. See, because. And listen, let me say this in passing. When our ancestors was in Egypt, God sent someone over there to deliver his people. But it wasn't the man himself. God did the deliverance, if you know what I mean. And see, over here, we don't have a priest. Moses was a priest. His father and mother, they were Levites. You can read it. I got it written down. It's in Exodus. I think it's chapter 2. But if you go there and read it, you will see that Moses, he was a priest. And see, God is going to send a prophet, a priest, to come back and deliver us. He never said he was going to send me, nor anyone else, to lead his people out of Egypt, nor to turn the hearts of the people. He said, "I will send you Elijah the prophet." And my sisters and brothers, that's who we have to look for. I mean, surely God has teachers like myself and others, but let's don't get it twisted. I can't deliver anyone, and I will never ever try to lead anyone any place. My job is only to teach Israel what thus says the Lord, and nothing more. But you have these people, you know, that call themselves teachers, and they go off on these deep trips, you know, and then take people along with them, and that's what happened to our sisters and brothers that went over there to Guyana. I mean, but if you just sit back, you know what I mean, and ask the Holy One to send you someone who will teach you what thus said the Lord, and not only that, you read it for yourself. But we have to get away from that, because we're going to get ourselves in trouble. Now let's go to our lesson. Now let's go to the book of Jeremiah, the 30th chapter, and we're going to read here. And look what it says. It says, "The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Thus speak the Lord God of Israel, saying, Write these, all the words that I have spoken unto thee, in a book. For lo, the days are come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. Notice what he says. He did not say LD. He did not say someone else. I mean, all these other people that are saying that they're teachers, he never called their name. He said, I'm going to do this. So why would you follow someone else on a notion that you got to do this great exodus? He said, I'm going to do it. Not a man, but he said, I am going to do this. Now let's go forward here. Now look what he says. And these are the words that the Lord spake concerning Israel and Judah. I mean, Israel and concerning Judah. For thus said the Lord, we have heard the voice of trembling and fear and not of peace. And ask ye now and see whether a man do travail with child, where I do see every man with his hands on his loins as a woman in travail, and all faces are turned into plainness. Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. All right, now God's saying that he's going to save Jacob. He's going to save Israel. All right, now we're going to go to the book of Zechariah here in a moment, but I want you to get this in your mind. And God is talking about he is going to deliver his people, not someone else. God said that I am going to do it. Now let's go a little further here in Jeremiah, the 30th chapter. We have verse 8. It says, for it shall come to pass in that day, said the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and I will bust the bands, and strangers shall no longer serve themselves of him. In other words, it's going to come the day that he's going to take the power of our enemy off of our heads. All right? You can't do it. I can't do it. Nobody can do it. God has to do this. You and I, as his children, must understand that God is the one that is going to deliver his people, not another man. So get that out of your mind. Get it out of your system. Get it out of your spirit. There is no man that is going to deliver you, only the Most High. All right, now let's go forward here. Let's read verse 9. It says, but they shall serve the Lord their God and David their king, whom I will raise up unto them. Therefore, fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, said the Lord. Neither be dismayed, O Israel, for lo, I will save thee from afar, and thy seed from the land of their captive. And Jacob shall return, and shall be in rest, and be quiet, and none shall make him afraid. Now, y'all remember that now. Look what he says. You know? This is what he says. I'm going to bring them back, and then they're going to be at peace. Now, if you think about those people over there, they're not at peace. So, you know he can't be talking about them. He's talking about us. Now, verse 11 says, for I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee. Though I make a full end of all nations, whether I have scattered thee. See that? Scattered thee, yet I will not make a full end of thee, but I will correct thee in measure, and I will not leave thee altogether unpunished. For thus said the Lord, thy bruise is uncurable, and thy wound is grievous. There is none to plead thy cause, that thou mightest be bound up. Thou hast no healing medicine. All thy lovers have forgotten thee, that they seek thee not. For I have wounded thee with a wound of an enemy, with the chastisement of a cruel one, for the multitude of thy iniquity, because thy sins were incurable. He said, why criest thou for thy affliction? Thy sorrow is increased, incurable, for the multitude of thy iniquity, because thy sins were increased. I have done these things unto thee. Now God, he is saying that he have done these things unto you. Now let's get on down here and read the rest of it. It says, therefore, all that devour thee shall be devoured, and all thine adversaries, every one of them shall go into captivity, and they shall spoil thee, shall be spoiled, and all that prey upon thee will I give for a prey. For I will restore health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, saith the Lord, because they call thee an outcast, saying, this is Zion, whom no man seeketh after. Thus saith the Lord, behold, look what he says, I will bring again the captivity of Jacob tents and have mercy on his dwelling places, and the city shall be built up her own heap, and the places shall remain after the manner thereof. Now God is saying that he's gonna do all this for his children. All right, now let's go to Zechariah. Now watch it right here. Now I want you guys to pay close attention to the reading now. Okay, now look what it says in Zechariah 14. But we need to read 13 too, but in your spare time, you go back and read it, and you can see here that God is talking about Israel and the things that they did and how he turned against them, and then he came back to them. You know, God has done this over and over with Israel. He had punished them and turned his head from them, and then he came back and had mercy on them and built them back up. But now look what he says. So now I want you to take time with this and think about what you're reading, and then you're going to see what I'm talking about here. Now look what he says in chapter 14, book of Zechariah. It says, behold, the day of the Lord cometh, and thy spoils shall be divided in the midst of thee. All right? Now look what he says. He says, for I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. He said he's going to gather all nations together for battle, and the cities shall be taken. Now he's talking about all of these cities, all of these places that he is that had a problem with Jerusalem. He called them out to battle. Now get this in your mind now. Once he called them out to battle, all the men are gone from these cities, all around about, all of them. And I'm gonna show it to you. All these cities and, you know, different places, all the men are going out to battle. All right, because God have called them out to battle with them. Now let's read verse 2 again. He said, for I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle. Get that in mind. And the cities shall be taken. Not Jerusalem. Okay? Not Jerusalem. But all these cities that it's going to be taken. And the houses raffle, and the women ravish, and half of the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off, shall be cut off from the city. In other words, some gonna leave, and then the ones that left are not gonna be able to come back. But now get this in your mind. He's talking about all those that had a controversy with Jerusalem. All right. Now look what he says, and now keep that in mind. And then you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. He said, then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations. See what I'm saying? Now he's going to fight against those nations. He's talking about all these nations that came against Jerusalem. All right? Now look what he says. And when he fought in that day and against those nations as when he fought in the day of battle, and his foot shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west, and there shall be a very great valley. Still talking about the people that he have called out to battle against, who had a controversy against Jerusalem. This is what he's talking about. Now keep that in mind. And look what he says. He says, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. All right? Are y'all with me? He's saying that he's going to stand on this mountain, and then one part going to be moved this way, another part going to move this way, because we're getting ready to battle. All right, now look what he says. And ye shall flee, to the valley of the mountains. Not Israel, not anyone that's in Jerusalem. He's talking to the one that he have called out to battle. He's not talking to Israel or any of them, telling them they gotta flee any place. He is talking about those who he have called out that has a controversy against Jerusalem. Look what he says here. Ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, and from the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azal. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. All right, now let's go to the book of Amos. Now watch this right here. Watch this, my sisters and brothers. Now let's look at this right here. Now, like I said, pay close attention. I'm not going to be able to read it all, but I'm going to give you a project, and I want you to read this in your time. Just watch the video and then come back and just read it all in your spare time, and you will see it come together just like a puzzle. But believe me, it is not talking about your sisters and brothers going to Israel, trying to go and flee to no mountain. Look, Israel is a slave. Israel is up under a curse. Israel don't have no money to be going nowhere. So how can anyone, not on that, he says in Deuteronomy 28, he said, you should not see it no more. So my question is, how can you go back, follow behind what somebody else is telling you, talking about you going back to Israel so that you can go to a mountain? Even if you could go to a mountain, you can't rush God. That's not going to make him come. That's like you have a school bus that comes at 7 o'clock in the morning. It be at your stop every day at 7 o'clock in the morning. You can go out there at 5 o'clock. That don't mean that you can make the bus come in earlier. I mean, it's stupid. Even the team, think about it. Even if you could go up into the mountains, wherever you want to go, you can't rush God. You can't make him come in any sooner than his appointed time. God has a time that he's going to come back on his own. He doesn't need your help, not mine. I mean, my sister and brother, you got to see this thing for what it is. You can't just let someone just tell you something, then you jump on it. Oh, we got to make a mad exodus out of here. Where are you going to go? There are God's people that are so badly cursed, even in this day and time, some of them probably don't even have a damn bicycle. Now, how can part of his people go and then some of them can't go? Do you not know that when Moses brought our ancestors out, everybody came? And didn't part of them go? All of them came at the same time. So how in the hell can some of y'all talk about going back to Israel and then the rest of us stay here? I mean, God is the same. He doesn't change. Seems like a red flag should come and say, now something strange about it. No, I better not fool with that. Don't say something that you hear somebody else say, you know, just because it may be catchy and it may sound like it's right. That doesn't mean that it's right. Now, let's look at Amos, the first chapter. Let's look at chapter 1 here, okay? And we can read down to verse 3. It says, the word of Amos, who was among the herdmen of Tekoa, which he saw concerning Israel in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and in the day of Jeroboam, the son of Josiah, king of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. See that? Do you remember that? He said over here in Ezekiel, the 14th chapter, where he said that in chapter 5, he said, ye shall flee to the valley of the mountain, for the valley of the mountain shall reach unto Azal. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the day of Uzziah, king of Judah. See that? Israel is not fleeing. Now watch this right here. And he said, the Lord will roar from Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the inhabitants of the shepherds shall mourn, and the top of camels shall wither. Thus saith the Lord, for three transgressions of who? Damascus. See that? Not Israel. And for I will not turn away the punishment thereof, because they have threshed Galilee with thrashings in instruments of iron. Now it goes on down. If you go on down and just read all of these countries here, God is dealing with. God is dealing with because of what they did to Israel. Now let's go back here to Zechariah the 14th chapter. And look what it says. The latter part of that. It says, in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with him. See that, my sisters and brothers? This is what is going to happen once he calls us back. We're going to be in rest. But we don't have to run. The enemy has to run, because now God is calling them out to battle. Not Israel. Israel don't have to run at all. He said he's going to save us. So my sisters and brothers, don't be caught off guard by what you hear. There's a lot of people that are trying to teach that are not teachers. And they're leading so many people astray. But like I say, if you read over here in Amos the first chapter, you'll see all these countries. God said that the third and the fourth are transgressions. You say, oh, I got to punish you for this. I got to punish you for this. But this is not talking about Israel fleeing any place, my sisters and brothers. These are the enemies. These are the nations that had a controversy against Jerusalem. Now let's go ahead and read verse 6. He says, it shall come to pass in that day that the light shall not be clear nor dark, but it shall be one day which shall be known to the Lord, not day nor night, but it shall come to pass at evening time, it shall be light, and it shall be in that day the living waters shall go forth from Jerusalem, half of them toward the former sea, and half of them toward the hinder sea. In summer and in winter shall it be, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day shall there be one Lord, and his name one. Now my question is, where is Jesus? All you Jesus freaks out there that's so much in love with Jesus, where is Jesus at? I don't see Jesus any place on here. But anyway, let us look at another scripture here. Now we have gotten that cleared up. Israel, I hope you understand. You can't go anywhere. God is going to gather us. Not another man take you any place. Don't let nobody take you nowhere. Don't let anyone mislead you and tell you this and that. No, no. Read it for yourself. God says that if God says he, well, not if. God said it. God said he's going to gather us from all the four corners of the earth. Now, why does man always want to try to interfere and do what God says that he has to do? And see, that's more or less like Christianity. You know, we get in our little peanut brain that we can do something, you know, that God can't do. God never asked us to help him gather his people. He said, I'm going to gather my people. And not only that, if you read the Old Testament and go back, every time they went into captivity, God sent them into captivity. And every time they came out, guess who bought them out? It wasn't me, it wasn't you, it wasn't our ancestors. God bought them out. So why would we think, even in this day, that, oh, well, we got to have elder somebody, or elder this, or teacher that. No. We got it twisted. God is God by himself. We didn't make God, he made us. So we need to stay in our place. He called you to be a teacher, teach the word. Don't go off on these ego trips, you know, trying to be something that you're not, because you're not God. And neither am I. So we need to keep ourselves, you know, in a low profile when it comes to the Most High. All right? Now, let us go here to the book of Joel. Let's go there. We're going to read Joel here. Now, watch it right here. Joel, the third chapter. We're going to start at verse 11. Look what it says here. It says, assemble yourselves, and come all ye heathens, and gather yourselves together round about. Hear the cause the mighty one is to come down. O Lord, let the heathens be weakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there I will set to judge all the heathens round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get ye down, from the press is full. The fats overflow from their wickedness is great. Multitude in the valley of decision, for the Lord, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. The sun and the moon shall be darkened, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. The Lord shall also roar out of Zion, and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people, and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall ye know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall no stranger pass through her any more. Okay? And it shall come to pass in that day that the mountains shall drop down new wine, and the hills shall flow with milk, and all the rivers of Judah shall flow with water, and the fountain shall come forth of the house of the Lord, and shall water the valley of Shittim. Egypt shall become a desolate, and Edom shall be a desolate wilderness, for the violence against the children of Judah, because they had shed innocent blood in their land. But Judah shall dwell forever, and Jerusalem from generation to generation, for I will cleanse their blood that I have not clean, for the Lord dwelleth in Zion. See that, my sisters and brothers? God says, I'm going to do all this. Not no man. And my sisters and brothers, it's right here in the pages. All we need to do is just take a little time. Take a little time and just ask the Father, you know, to show us, you know. Because it doesn't come to me just like that. I mean, sometimes I sit down and it just comes together. But sometimes I think look at it 3 or 4 or 5 different times. And then, you know, sometimes I get worried and frustrated, you know, because I know that it's there, but I can't find it, you know. And I know what I'm looking at. It should come together because it looks strange to me, you know, and I'm not really seeing what I'm supposed to be seeing. So I get frustrated and I go back and I leave and I go back and I leave. And then I tell the wife, I said, babe, I said, look, this is, I just can't get it right. I know that it's there, but where is it at? And then sooner or sometime later, he'll just show it to us. And that's how it is, my sister and brother. I mean, like I say, I am not a college grad, you know, anything like that. But I know that whatever he shows me, I must show it to my sister and brothers, because it belongs to us. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to us. He said it belongs to the children. And I know that the children will get it. The others, if they get it, they get it. If don't, they go. But I know that it is for the children. And that's why I work so diligently here. Not only me, but all of us here at LightOfMinimal.org. We work, you know, sometimes tireless, you know, hours over and over looking at things. You know, my wife, she looking at something while I'm at work. And then, well, we conversing back and forth over the phone, you know, about, well, look at this, look at that, you know. And I'm at work, you know, and I'm on my spare time, you know, the Father, he'll give me something, and we'll just go back and forth, you know, all day long until I get home. And then once I get home, we go back at it again. And then he just began to reveal his word to us. But my sisters and brothers, you know, I have a great love and a great concern for our people. And I don't want our people to go astray, you know, trying to do what's right. You can be trying to do what's right and doing wrong the whole while you're doing something. That's why, I ask you to read. And like I said, if you have any questions, I have a job also, and I also have a family. And if I don't get right to you right away, don't be discouraged. Like I say, hit me up on Facebook, you know, and leave your questions and your comments there, and then we'll get to some. I mean, some kind of way. I'm going to get you a response. Now, I may not be able to teach what you want me to teach right then. It may take several weeks, but eventually we're going to try to get to it, because there are so many other things that I be doing and that the Father helped me doing. So I just can't just drop everything and say, well, okay, well, I got to get yours, you know, your request, because there are others that have requests also. And by right, I tried my best, you know, to answer everyone, because all your questions are valid. All your questions are important to us, you know, so we try to answer you as prompt as we possibly can. So just hang in there, and as I said before, you know, forgive us for being late last week, you know, but we're gonna try to get it straightened out this week. You know, we've been working on it, and we're going to try to get it to you at a decent time. All right? Now, that being said, let me go forward here. Let us look at the book of Isaiah. Let's go to Isaiah. Isaiah, the 43rd chapter here. Let us go there. Isaiah, the 43rd chapter. Okay. Now, let's look at this, my sister and brother. Let's look at verses 1 through 7, then we're going to jump down to 9 and go to 13. Okay, it says, But now, thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. When thou passest through the water, I will be with thee, and through the river, they shall not overflow thee when thou walkest through. The fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I given Egypt for a ransom, Ethiopia and Sinbad for thee. Since thou wast precious in mine sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore, I will give men for thee and people for thy life. Fear not, for I am with thee. I will bring thy seed from the east and gather thee from the west. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, keep not back. Bring my sons from far and my daughters from the ends of the earth, even everyone that is called by my name, Israel, for I have created him for my glory. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. Now, if you look at these writings, my sisters and brothers, who is doing the gathering? Who is doing the gathering? That's my question. See, like I say, in due all respect, respect it due to everyone, you know. But what I'm saying is this: you can't take to heart what everyone tells you. You have to look at it for yourself. And even though if you can't see it, you know, you gotta think about it. Think about it, reading the scriptures. Who did the gathering? Who did the delivering? God did, not man. Can't no man help you? Now let's go a little further here. Let's jump down to verse 9 here. It says, let all the nations be gathered together, and let all the people be assembled who among them that can declare this and show us former things. Let them bring forth their witness that they may be justified, or let them hear and say, it is true. Yea, ye are my witness, said the Lord, and my servants whom I have chosen, that ye may know and believe and may understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, neither shall there be after me. See, God said there was nobody before him, neither is one going to come after him. So my question to all the Christians is, God said there's nobody going to come after him. Where did Jesus come from? Now, he said he came from God. He said he's the Son of God. God said there's no God that was before him, neither is there going to be a God that's going to come after him. Where did Jesus come from? He didn't come from God. No, why? Because he's not a God. He's not. He haven't done a damn thing for you guys. Nothing.
And you hooping and hollering, praying and trusting him, and he hadn't done a damn thing for you. Everything that you have accomplished, the Most High did it. But you didn't know he did it because you was giving credit to one that is pretending but not doing anything. Now, let's go a little further here. Let's go to Malachi. Let's go to Malachi. Malachi, the 4th chapter. Now watch the man of my sister and brother. And look at Malachi 4 and 4. Look what it says. He said, "Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I command unto him in Horeb for all Israel, with the statutes and my judgment." Know what he told him? Let's go to Exodus. Let's go to Exodus 20. This is what he told him. Now watch it right here, my sisters and brothers. Exodus 20. Let's read verse 4. Look what it says. He said, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images of any likeness of anything that is in heaven, or above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the generation unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me." That's what he told him. That's what he told him. He said, "Remember that law. Remember that. If you remember that, you can't go wrong." Then he says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." See that? He said he was going to send you Elijah. He didn't say that he was going to send you anybody else that was going to so-called deliver you. That's why, I mean, we keep saying it over and over. I mean, I can't stress it enough in these videos. I ask you to read along with me. I ask you to listen to the words. That's all I can do. I mean, if he said that he going to send you Elijah, then damn it, don't look for nobody else. Don't look for anybody else to deliver you. Wait for Elijah. I mean, if you believe that you're Hebrew and you believe what the writings say, then do what it says. Wait on him. And we just read the scriptures together where he said he's going to cleanse our blood. He's going to do it. We can't do it. Can't nobody do it for us. He said he's going to do it. But anyway, let's go a little further here. Let's go to 1 Kings 18. 1 Kings 18:36. 1 Kings 18:36. Now look what it says, my sister and brother. It says, "And it came to pass at that time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word." See that? Now think about this right here. If any of you guys read back and think about it, the only person that could do a sacrifice was a priest. So Elijah is holding two offices. He's a prophet and a priest. And just like Moses. Moses was a prophet and a priest. My sisters and brothers, God doesn't change his order. He says that Moses brought your ancestors out. Now I'm going to send you Elijah. So my sisters and brothers, I ask you to read, to study, to meditate. And if you need any help, go back to some of the videos and listen at the wording. And then think about it, and it'll take you to another scripture that maybe I hadn't even taught on. But it's all to help you. It's all to help us. We are all in this together. It's not me and y'all or them or they. It's all of us. We are all, if you're Hebrew, I'm only talking about my people. We are all one. It's not that I'm one and you one. No. We're all the same. And when God woke me up, he should have woken up. Not should have, but he did. Maybe you didn't know that you was awake, but you knew that something was different. You know, God woke us all up at the same time. There is no more waking up. When he put us to sleep, he didn't put some to sleep over there and put some. No, he said he put all to sleep at the same time. Because you know what? We're all tied one to another. We're all one. That's why I always stress to all of my sisters and brothers that we are one. It is not me, them, they. It's we. We as a people. My sisters and brothers, we here at LightOfMeNumber.org, we wish all of our sisters and brothers a happy Sabbath. Until next time, shalom.